Hi there, and welcome to a scorching day at Snitterfield Res. My name's Jan Porter, and I picked a really terrible day to do a spot of bream fishing on the swim feeder, but I've got one on now, so it's a good start to the session. I'll get this one out and we'll have a look at the basics of swim feeder fishing as I do it for bream, and hopefully you'll pick up a few tips along the way. The most conventional way to catch one, but everyone counts. There you go, nice little skimmer. Okay, well, as you can see in my usual way, I've got everything set out to hand, and this is very important. You'll have to forgive me wearing shades today, but we've got temperatures well above 20 degrees and almost flat calm conditions. So as I said earlier, not really conducive for catching fish, but I have caught a few skimmers. There's a few roach knocking around. We're in the middle of the day now, so it's the worst possible time, but the best possible time to show you a thing or two about our fish for bream. The first rig that I'm using is the Paternoster, and I have to say that out of the two rigs I've got today, this is probably the one that's caught me more bream than anything. It's a grip mesh feeder set on about 4 or 5 pound main line, and we've got a little tiny leg there of line, which is the actual main line, coming down to a hook length of about 2 pounds today. And then I've got a size 18 hook, and I'm fishing double red maggot. A grip mesh feeder itself, I like them for lots of reasons. They're very aerodynamic. They do what they say. They grip the ground bait, and they're very, very robust. So you're not having to keep, you know, replacing them every 2 minutes because they blow up. So very, very durable piece of kit. And I'll chuck this out while I continue to talk about it, but simply just pinch the ground bait in there. You've got to get the ground bait right in the first place. Nice fluffy ground bait, and that's a 50-50 mix of lake and ground trout pellet. Couple of red maggots. You can't beat red maggots for bream. I know pellet's the big thing these days, but even so, on a very heavily fished water on pellet, the red maggot will outscore them on certain occasions. In terms of the cast, we'll do this once, and this applies pretty much to every type of casting we're running line. Just before I make the cast, I'm just going to pull the line through the rings. This just tells me, it communicates to me that the line's free. I've got no wrap rounds across the top. And then just a quick look behind me, make sure there's nothing there. Pick the spot I want to aim at, and then just a gentle little lob. That's about 25 yards. Quickly sink the tip of the rod under the water. And I'm just going to watch now as these two V's form on top of the water, get closer and closer together. I'm also going to be watching the quiver tip as well, just in case I get one just as it settles on the water. Now, the setup itself couldn't be any simpler. I've got a butterfly rod rest on the front of the rod. I'm quite happy to have a little bit less rod sticking over the end of the butterfly rod. It's not carp fishing, not likely to get a wrap round. And I've got the butt section of the rod just resting on my knee. It's very, very comfortable. It's hands free. I'm straight on the rod. Keep net to hand, landing net, platform, and a spare rod on the pole roost. Incidentally, the reel I'm using today is a small bait runner. And if I was fishing anywhere where I was likely to catch or connect with a big carp, then I'd automatically flip it into the bait runner mode, which sets it on a much lighter drag setting. That's just a really nice safety net, a fail-safe device, which will mean that when you just take your eye off the ball and the fish, the carp in particular, grab hold of the rod, they're not going to drag it in the water, and you're in control at all times. Okay, so it's just a case now of sitting back, just waiting for that feeder to allow the ground bait to dissolve through. Maybe every now and then just twitch the line and just bring the hook bait onto where the feeder has deposited all the ground bait, and then just sit tight, looking for action. I just bite straight away. And you could hear that bait run. I left that on deliberately. You could hear that bait runner there when I picked up as it went into play. So it's very, very gentle setting there, and that's just prevented me from probably getting broken off by a big carp if it had run at 100 miles an hour. This is a front drag reel. There seems to be a lot more of a lean towards front drag reels these days in the match scene. Obviously I'm not fishing a match today, I'm just pleasure fishing. Just as well, really. Okay, so just repeat the process. Tip under the water. And again, the whole point of this, it's all about ergonomics, really. It's all about time and motion. And concentrate on the most important aspect, and that is on the bites. Well, that was a bit of a rare treat. I mean, Ed Bailiff just been down and showed me a rod he had built in 1960, a split cane one. And he's brought me a bit of luck, because as he's walked away, the tip's gone round on my 11-foot quiver rod, and I've landed a bream. So thanks for that, Owen. You can hear him chuckling in the background. That's a lovely fish. This is a purist light specialist rod. It's actually a three-piece rod. You get an extra section to make it a 12.5-foot, but this is at 11 foot here. Love the configuration of this. It's really my cup of tea. Nice short handle, cork, traditional looking thing, olive. Just amount of rings that you need. And on the quiver tip side of it, you get a couple of extra tips, as you do with most rods these days. Ranging from about 3/4 of an ounce up to 3 ounces. And I've opted for somewhere in between. I always find that out of 3 quiver tips, you'll find one that actually marrows into the bank a little bit better. Despite the fact that it's flat calm today, there's very little toe. And it is kicking, even that little toe, just kicking the tip round. And I'm getting all the bites I need. There's no problems whatsoever with the sensitivity. So it's a two-piece rod as we stand now, and 11 foot. It's got plenty of backbone in it, which means that if I do connect with a bigger fish, a carp or something, provided I've got the right sort of hook length diameter, I'm going to be able to gaffer it, you know. So just go through the motions again. Nice gentle cast, about 20, 25 yards. I'm not clipped up. I'll talk about clipping up in a moment. Just sink that line. You can actually treat your line with a bit of washing up liquid. I say line, this is actually braid on this rod, but it's always worse when you've got no ripple. It tends to make it harder to cut through the surface tension. So I'll sit there then, I'll just wait for another bite, hopefully. Maybe Owen will come back and bring me a little bit more luck. But just to go through again the reel, a couple of features, a line clip I mentioned. I'm not clipping up today, but that's a means, if you want to actually prescribe a length of line to cast to an accurate distance. A lot of the match anglers now use this for casting accuracy to islands and casting up to features. There's just one word of warning if you're going to be using a line clip, that you make sure 100% that it's not going to damage the line or your main line underneath there. And that's really, really important and crucial for safety reasons. The other thing about the reel, which is fairly unique to Shimano reels, I guess, and that's the ARC spool. You can see it's got a chamfer here. And I've actually sort of underspooled it. If you look at reels that I used, say, 2 years ago, you'll find that they're all spooled up right to the max, right to the lip. And in this particular instance, it's set back probably 2 or 3 mil. And the reason being is that this chamfer actually levers the line up and makes it come off a little bit easier, which is also an advantage. The other thing about the reel, which I'll just mention, I've talked about the bait runner and the dual clutch. Double handle on this model. I'm a big fan of double handle reels. I think it adds a better balance. I don't have any problem whatsoever locating the handle. And finally, a real boon to these modern day reels is the fact that there's hardly any play. When you've got the anti-reverse in the on mode, so you can't wind backwards, all you've got to do is literally move the reel barely not even a millimetre, and it won't drop back. In the olden days, there used to be about, you know, 10 or 12 positions on a reel, so you get in a spot and it wouldn't sit right and drop back, and you could just never get that right curvature in the rod. I'm getting a little bit of action on the tip here, but you can just set that rod, just put a little bit more tension in it, and this just means that you can get the right tension that you want on your quiver tip. I'll just wind this in and then we're going to have a look at the other rod setup, which a lot of anglers use now for bream fishing. Okay, so what we've got here is identical rod. I'm a real big fan of using identical rods. If you've got a match pair of rods, I think there's a consistency in the terms of where you cast, the distance you're casting, you're going to be more accurate, and also when you're playing fish, it means that you know exactly what the rod will or won't do when it comes under max compression, and that can determine what hook lengths and what size hook you use. So that's it for me. On this particular rod, I'm using a fighting drag reel. Now this is a Stradic. These came around 10 or 12 years ago on the scene, and as you can see, this has got a drag knob on the back. It's a rear drag reel, and it's also got a secondary drag, which is the fighting drag. Now in the central position, that's pretty much the optimum where I'll use it most of the time. If I want to set it so, you know, a big fish can take a lot of line, then I'll turn it to the left or anti-clockwise, and can you hear already? That's slacking the clutch and that's ticking away, and that means if a big fish takes it, just like on a bait runner, it will allow line to come off the reel. Obviously, if that happens and I'm playing a fish, it's clicking away there merrily, bring it back to the central position, and if there's not enough clutch on there, I can always trim it as I'm playing the fish with my left hand and put a bit more clutch on. It's actually a fantastic system. I've used it a lot in my fishing since coming out of the match fishing scene, coming away from back winding on light hook lengths using the drag, and I find it to be a very, very useful way of playing fish. Again, it's got the ALC spool. Cosmetic wise, a bit incongruous. When it first came out, it was a bit of a shock to everybody, but it's been one of the best selling reels, and they're beautiful reels, very smooth. Again, double handle. And pretty much all you could wish for in a reel. Now on this one I'm using monofilament nylon in about a 4 to 5 pound breaking strain. It doesn't have to be an exact science. Again, this will just cope with the extra punch if you want to cast another 20 or 30 yards out to what I'm doing today. And also it'll be a little bit more durable through the rings if you're playing fish and bagging it with big weights. The setup I've got on this one is not on a paternoster. This is a safety rig, in as much as the actual feeder just pops in on a little tiny silicon. I've modded this. It just pops in onto the swivel, and then in the unlikely event of breaking off when you're playing a fish or casting off so it leaves a baited hook in the water, it's not going to stick with the feeder. The fish will just pull that and it'll detach it, and that's a very useful way of being environmentally friendly and fish safe. Short hook length, that's actually quite a long hook length if you're using a hair rig. I would say a lot of anglers use slightly heavier 16s or 18 diameter hook lengths, use pellet bands or maybe a hair rig with a boilie on it. And what I've done with this one, I'm using this with maggots today. I'm actually broken off the bottom of this flat feeder, so I can just put a couple of dead maggots on the inside of there, and then pretty much use it in the time-honoured fashion with one of these moulds here, which are absolute boon to angling. So literally, I'll just load that up, put the maggots, the dead maggots on there, just get all this lined up so any extra line is out of the way. It's drying out a little bit, and I'll point out that I'm using a zipped-up covered ground bait bowl, and then you just have the absolute perfect food parcel there with a hook bait in that bottom bit where I remove that rib, and the fish will come down, peck away at that, and then you've got the maggots there, literally suck, blow, and then they're gone. As long as it's safe, that's the most important thing. It's a nice steady cast. You don't want to cast too hard. That ground bait there's drying out a little bit, as I say. Again, same applies whether you're using braid on the main line or using mono. Tip the rod down about 6 inches under the water. Just keep teasing that gently. I'm trying not to pull it too hard because I don't want the feeder to draw towards me or to dislodge that ground bait. Just use a bit of pressure. See the two V's come together, then you know it's completely sunk under the water. Put a little set in the actual tip and then ready to go. Well, one thing I didn't mention was really go into a little bit more detail about using braid. It's something that you should really study the fishery rules to see whether it's allowed first and foremost. And in all honesty, although I'm fishing it today, it's a little bit more advanced in terms of fishing. What it tends to do, because there's no stretching braid, this is this means that it puts a lot more load on the rod itself, so that when the rod compresses, it knocks a lot harder, and that can cause the hook to bounce out, or if you're not on your guard, can even cause the hook length to break. So that's the first thing to be aware of braid. The benefits of using braid are that it's very low diameter for breaking strain. This is a 20 pound breaking strain, but it's the same diameter as 4 pound mono, so you've got a lot of advantages in terms of strength. But if you want to compromise on that and use it, then what you can do is you can attach some mono into it as either, whatever you want to call it, a shock absorber or a shock leader. And what this will do is it will just take the sting and add a little bit of stretch to your setup. So it helps on casting, it just doesn't make it so rigid. And also when you're playing bigger fish, it will just stretch and just yield a little bit, just protecting you from losing the fish by hook breaks or by pulling out. That's about it really. I hope you've enjoyed this little session, and we'll see you again soon on the riverbank or possibly back here.
land.